Okay, should I win again?
Yes. Hi everyone and welcome to GovTech Decoded, where we decode technical speak. In this series, we'll discuss hot tech topics and how the Singapore government leverages technologies to build tech for public good. I'm GovTechie Alicia and I'm your host for today. We have Nicole, Kenneth and Hock Chuan back with us again. Yay, welcome back. Maybe a quick introduction for those who didn't join us the first time round.
Hello, I'm Kenneth and I lead the Empower program in GovTech.
Hi, I'm Nicole and I'm also part of the Empower team.
And I'm Hock Chuan. I lead the Launch Innovation Initiative in GovTech.
So welcome to GovTech Decoded. In our previous episode, we decoded the ins and outs of prompt engineering and spoke about how GovTech is upskilling public officers with skills to leverage the power of GenAI. And since we have our three AI experts here, can we talk a bit about the difference between machine learning and AI?
Sure. I think this is a common question that people often have, and they mix machine learning or ML or even use it interchangeably with AI. So AI actually refers to a family of methods to make machines more like humans. And for ML, it's actually a subset of AI that specifically involves training algorithms and using statistical models to analyze and draw inferences from patterns of data, like training a computer to learn and adapt without giving it specific instructions. So one example is like how Netflix gives you recommendations, and it does so based on patterns of your viewing history, of other users similar profile to you, and then it gives you a recommendation of the shows or the next Korean show to watch.
So I think like machine learning is different from traditional programming also. So in traditional programming, the developer sets the rules, the logic and the flow, which gives the program specific instructions on how to behave.
Okay, so it's like giving kind of a framework that the machine that learns around instead of actual rules
to follow.
That's right.
And then another term that we frequently hear is LLMs. So could you decode then what the LLM is and how it works?
Sure. LLM stands for Large Language Model. So a large language model is an AI model that is trained to understand, generate and manipulate human languages. So this gives the model an ability to read and understand your intention better. So for example, right, the LLM is able to reply to you in a more human-like way, engaging in more engaging natural conversation and answering questions and providing explanations. So for example, in the past, when you search on Google or Yahoo, right, it's mainly based on keywords matching. But right now with AI, these engines can actually comprehend the questions and give you better answers.
For example, if you want to go to a restaurant for a meal, and instead of what we normally do, put in a term, some places, for example, on a Google search, and then you have to go through a bunch of information, recommendations or pages and all that. Right now, you go through an LLM, you put in a prompt, and it gives you a response, much like a human friend or even a concierge. That gives you direct answers to your question in a more human-like manner. Yeah.
That mini concierge that knows everything.
Correct, correct. And communicates with you just like a human.
It's true. There was this study that was conducted in 2015 by the researchers at the University of Cambridge and Stanford. So they found that Facebook actually knows you better than your friends and can predict your behavior more accurately. So Facebook is something you have to invite to your birthday party now.
Oh wow, it's super creepy. I have a thing for like Facebook down there and like, have you
I know you so well. Yeah.
But that's only how does Singapore like use AI then?
Yeah, that's a great question. So from Kenneth's example, you can see the power of AI even in the small parts of our daily life. So in the Singapore government, we recognize the power and benefits of AI too. So at GovTech, we want to help more agencies leverage on AI to improve the way they work or improve service delivery for citizens. So we recently developed an AI-powered tool called Matchmaker. And it's a great example of how we are using AI to improve efficiency within the public sector. So Matchmaker is designed to help public officers find relevant technology solutions for their day-to-day challenges.
Oh, so like you see, many public officers often face difficulties when trying to find the right tech solutions for their work. So it can be time-consuming, it can be overwhelming due to the vast amount of information available. And sometimes they simply might lack the technical know-how to assess the different options that they have.
Yeah, that's where Matchmaker comes in. So public officers can simply key in the problem statements into Matchmaker, and the AI will search and find the most relevant technology for their needs.
I'm going to use that tool.
Please do.
And I think many people and organizations today actually already know about AI and recognize its benefits. But when it comes to implementation, adoption, or quantifying the ROI, that's what we see them commonly struggle.
Yeah, and therefore to help, right, actually we had an initiative called Launch. And under this initiative, we have Launchpad, which is a platform for public officers to brainstorm ideas, experiment with AI tools available out there, and to learn about what are the common AI applications. And besides that, we also run hackathons every 2 months regularly. And this is where we invite agencies to submit their problem statements, and we work with them to solve it using AI solutions. So for instance, one of the most recent projects is focused on the generation of translation across the 4 different languages. So during the hackathon, we develop AI-powered applications that not only stores, search, as well as retrieve past translation across the 4 official languages in Singapore. And this very convenient, easy-to-use database contains vetted translation, and that's very important.
Yeah, so consistency is actually key in translations for us to communicate messages clearly to the public. For example, if a name of a particular scheme is translated differently across, you know, different materials that's put up by the government, then the public might find it confusing and will probably even hinder the effectiveness of the message.
So like, actually, when I talk to officers from other agencies, they often say that they lack resources. Like, some of them have to pay for their own subscription to AI tools.
Yeah, and I think, well, that's the reality for many teams and organizations as well. The lack of resources and knowledge is a blocker. Part of what we do at GovTech is then to actually drive digitalization across the Singapore government. So the Launch initiative really acts as a stepping stone for agencies to start transforming themselves one step at a time.
Yeah, I'm proud to share that over 1 year, we have around 3,000 monthly active users, and it has sparked over 1,000 ideas on Launchpad. Yes, thank you. Yeah, and it's very rewarding to witness the innovation that's happening across the agencies at this hackathon.
So these hackathons aren't just for tech experts, they're also for officers who might not have the technological background.
Exactly. So one of the key benefits of this hackathon is that we hope to create this space for public officers to understand how AI can work for them to solve the real-world challenges that they face in their daily work. So to facilitate this, we ensure that every hackathon team have at least one business user, and this business user will work very closely with the engineering experts. And this ensures that the prototypes that we build are not built in a vacuum, and it's increased the ownership of these ideas by the business teams as well.
So I think the rise of like no-code and low-code platforms also help.
Yeah, for sure, yeah.
Okay, so now is a good time to take a break with a game. Oh, everyone, we are going to play Tech Trivia. Are y'all good at it? Who knows? Okay, that's what you're going to find out. Okay, there's a twist. We'll be doing a tic-tac-toe edition. When you answer one right answer, you get to place your tile. Okay, we'll be playing 2 rounds in total to determine the winner. Y'all will first play a round of scissors, paper, stone to figure out who will automatically go to the final round.
Scissors, paper, stone.
Oh no! Okay, Nicole, you're straight to the second round. Kenneth, let's do round one, tic-tac-toe. Okay, first question. What does AI stand for? Raise your hand. Okay, Hock Chuan, first.
Artificial intelligence.
Very good. Self-explanatory, guys. Artificial intelligence is AI. Please put your towel. Okay, second question. Who is considered the father of artificial intelligence? Raise your hand. Okay, Kenneth.
D. Jeffrey Hinton.
No. Hock Chuan.
Alan Turing. No? Okay.
Okay, it's actually B. John McCarthy. He's widely regarded as the father of artificial intelligence, coining the term in his 1955 proposal for the 1956 Dartmouth Conference, the first AI conference. Oh, that was so long ago. AI was already around. Okay, that's so cool. Question 3. What is the primary language used for artificial intelligence programming? Yes, Hock Chuan.
Python.
Yes, very good. It's the most popular language for AI due to its simplicity and versatility, and it has a robust set of libraries. specifically tailored for AI. Question four. Which of the following is a technique used to teach AI without explicit programming? Yes, Kenneth.
Okay.
Yes,
learning.
Like supervised learning. It's a type of machine learning where the model is trained on a labeled data set, allowing the AI to learn to predict outcomes based on input data. Next question. What technology underlies Bitcoin and has applications in AI for secure transactions? Yes, Hock Chuan.
Blockchain?
Yes, correct. Blockchain tech is used for creating secure, immutable records, beneficial in AI applications that require secure data sharing like in healthcare. Okay, last question, guys. Okay, what is commonly used AI tech for recognizing human faces in photos? Yes, Hock Chuan.
Quite obvious, right? Facial recognition.
Not very good. It uses AI to identify or verify a person's identity using their face, commonly used in things like smartphones as well.
Okay.
To your towel.
Dun, 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 dun.
Yay. All right. Now we're on round two with Nicole and Hock Chuan.
Try all this.
Okay, all the best, guys. Okay, first question. Which AI capability involves understanding human language as it is spoken or written?
Me first. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Natural language processing.
Correct.
Yay.
NLP allows machines to understand and interpret human language, enabling applications like chatbots and virtual assistants. Second question. Which type of AI is capable of more than just specific tasks and can understand and reason about the world generally? 1, 2, 3. Okay, I go with Hock Chuan.
Okay, okay. Yes. Thanks. Is it artificial general intelligence?
Yes. AGI refers to a type of AI that has cognitive abilities across a broad range of tasks akin to human intelligence. Very good. Okay, question three. Which technology is used in AI models to predict outcomes based on historical data? Nicole.
Okay, machine learning.
Yes.
Okay.
Machine learning is a subset of AI that trains a machine how to learn and make predictions or decisions by analyzing data. Okay, question four. What kind of AI is used to detect and identify objects in images uploaded on social media platforms? Hock Chuan.
Image recognition AI?
Yes, correct. Image recognition AI is used extensively. Yes.
We'll be here till tomorrow, guys.
It's used extensively in social media platforms to detect and identify objects in images, which helps in automatic tagging and content filtering. Okay, number five. What is the AI term used to describe the process of teaching computers to make decisions from data? Yes, Hock Chuan. Not sure, but still trying.
Learning?
Okay, yes, the correct answer is learning here. Okay, the process where computers learn from data and make decisions based on the data they process is commonly referred to as machine learning.
Okay, should I win again?
Yes. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
Two-time champion.
Yeah.
Okay, so congratulations, Hock Chuan. Two times champion.
Thank you.
Our reigning AI king here right now. Let's head back to our discussions and like learn a bit more from everybody as well. So we were talking about the adoption of AI in the Singapore government. So I'm curious to know, did you guys face any challenges when getting public officers to adopt AI in their day-to-day work?
So I think one observation I have is that there are still public officers who have not even used GenAI, any of the GenAI's tools before. This is probably due to their lack of awareness of its potential and some of the use cases. One common perception could be that these technologies could be complex, and having to navigate tech jargons can be quite daunting to them as well. There are also fears about how AI might displace jobs that currently us as humans hold today. While these views are very real and understandable, we need to help them alleviate these concerns, and we do so through making, you know, fun initiatives like DET that we shared in the previous episode as well.
Yeah, when we work with the different hackathon teams, right, one of the concerns that was brought up was data security. So to address this, we have put in place rigorous measures to protect the data when we deal with LLM in collaboration with the cloud service provider like Azure and AWS. So our agreement with them is built on strict protocol. They are designed to prevent data logging and to ensure that the data is not utilized for training their AI models. And one of the focus areas for our AI practice group is also on responsible AI practices. And they will introduce tools that will help public officers develop, evaluate, and deploy and monitor AI systems in a safe, trustworthy, and ethical manner. Yeah.
I think for me, I feel the most important part of all of this is culture building. So I think it applies to any organization, not just governments. By creating an innovative culture, you really encourage your staff to be willing to try new things. They are excited to try, excited even to fail. And it's okay, because this trait is important. Technology will continue to change, and it's not about having the skills or the knowledge, but a mindset of constantly being willing to improve.
Yeah, I agree that culture plays an important role. And we have the right mindset, are willing to keep learning, right? Then even with all these new developments in technology, we'll still be able to adapt because we can still continue to learn.
Sure.
Okay, and to end off this episode, where do you guys see the future of like AI?
So I think no one can really say what the future of AI will be. But one thing is for sure, AI has and will continue to change the way we work and the way we deliver public services more effectively.
Yeah, one of the trends we see is how do we make AI available for everyone through open sourcing so that people will be able to train and fine-tune their model for their own use cases. So when it comes to government adoption, we also need to embrace AI cautiously. And government have to consider the issue of data security, sovereignty, carefully. And one of the advantages of open source AI is that you're able to run the model where you want to run it and have the assurance that the data will not stay within the country and if you were to host it locally in Singapore.
That's right. So while we wait for the logistics of deploying AI safely, we should continue to upskill public service officers in AI-related fields. So this way, we can ensure that when AI becomes ready for full-scale implementation, officers are not only familiar with it, but fully equipped to run it. So rather than waiting for the technology to mature, we should begin preparing for it right now.
Well said, guys. Thank you for sharing so many great insights today. And it's super exciting what the future holds for us. Maybe soon we'll have our very own Jarvis.
I wouldn't mind that.
Okay, so thank you, Hock Chuan, Nicole and Kenna, for joining us today. If you're keen to find out more about what we have discussed, you can check out our site at go.gov.sg/govtechdecoded.
And if you enjoyed this episode, do support us by sharing it with others and on social media. You can also connect with us on our LinkedIn pages and follow GovTech on our social media platforms at go.gov.sg/connect-with-govtech. We will leave the links in the description.
Thanks for joining us, and we'll catch you in the next GovTech Decoded.
Bye.